flattered and truly honored. I do want to thank the LGBT Initiative for hosting this event. They do wonderful work. The archive is extraordinary. And Kerry, anytime you want a job marketing at magazine, you've got it. Thank you for that pitch. I wanted to just start by, I was trying to think of a little story to introduce Don, and I realized the first and last time I met Don was actually for an Out magazine shoot. We were shooting for something called the Out 100. And for some reason, we got it, or I got it into my head, that we would style Don as this sort of very dapper gentleman sitting in a kind of country garden, roses sort of sprouting from the bushes. Don was in a lovely white boater and a suit. And we added a young artist into the shot, and we decided he should just be standing there wearing a speedo and a pair of garden shears in his hands. And I was quite happy with the shot. It came out really well. The issue looked great. And then I was showing it to a friend, and he said, "You know, this is great, but you got it all wrong." He said, "Don Bachardy should be the object of desire." So I would like to introduce you to your object of desire tonight, Don Bachardy.
I don't think who got it wrong. No, he was very attractive.
So, Don, I think you're going to start by reading some of your letters for us. Do you have anything picked out?
Yes, I'm going to read from Chris. This is from January 26, 1964. I was in New York at the time. In fact, that's when I got a job from Lincoln Kirstein to do portraits of the New York City Ballet, all of the featured dancers for a portfolio, which was supposed to be sold as a souvenir program and never got seen by the public. I only got a box of 100 copies never saw Lincoln again at the end of it. But anyway, we've been very good friends up until that point. And Lincoln and Chris first met in 1939 when Chris and Winston and Alden came to New York for the first time, in 38 actually that was. But anyway, this is a letter from Chris in written in 1964. And I think I must just have arrived in New York. Dearest love, just to let you know, I arrived safely. He was coming back from visiting me in New York. That's just to let you know, I arrived just, can you hear me?
Yes.
I arrived safely to find the house more or less in one piece. There was an earthquake described by Dorothy, she is our black maid, not our cleaning woman, and sometimes cook. There was an earthquake described by Dorothy as, "It sounded like the Chinese were coming." And as a result, the floor of the front bathroom is just a bit more cracked. Nothing else. A windstorm blasted those trailer plants in boxes which used to hang on the deck and broke a limb from the tree, but nothing serious. The garden is growing up all right. Some more rain got into your studio, but no damage. I moved a stack of drawings out of reach in case there is more. Today is cold and gray. Yesterday, I had a sort of flu and stayed in bed and slept hours and hours. Today, I'm better. Friday, Gavin and I went to see Burton and Liz, who were at Bay in the Beverly Wilshire en route to Toronto and Hamlet. They were very sweet when we finally got to them through a cordon of newsmen, photographers, and cops. And we had supper together, and Richard seemed quite terrific and not really fat at all. The beach at Falaise seems very much on. That was an adaptation of the Stevenson story that Chris was to write for him. He's very much on, and I and you, if you are free, will go to Boston in March and see Hamlet and make the final arrangements. Mountains of Christmas cards for both of us. He'd been away a long time. There was one from Jimmy Doherty. Looking for it today, I can't find it. So maybe you should call him. Also a little Juju candy man from the Smollets. Also, there are some brushes and pencils for you, left, I presume, by Jim Cole. He said he would do this, but no note and no money. I called Frank Wiley, who says he has heard nothing from Jim so far. The house is very clean and calm after India. I have been walking around in white socks and there isn't one speck of dirt on them. Dorothy is coming tomorrow, but more as a social call. So far, I have just spoken to her on the phone. I'm driving up Wednesday to see the Warner Brown show. That was Paul Warner and Bill Brown. They were close friends of ours and very good artists. Joe and Ben write that they will be home in about a week. That was our best heterosexual friends, Joe Lathwood and Ben Massley. I wrote back asking to have supper with us, me. He wrote to them asking to have supper with us, me, the evening they returned. Devon misses his dear love and hopes he will be able to come back soon. The time in New York with his kitten was very happy, a happy one for him. That camera mad Roddy McDowell has sent a really rather sweet picture of the animals in front of a window, waiting to be fed. Love from a wheezy but ever faithful old horse. Drop. And then there's a postscript. A Mr. A.M. Sheridan Smith writes from Melbourne, as Mr. White will be going away shortly, he was Chris's editor at Methuen, he asked me to write you about the jacket for a single man. I wonder if you have any ideas on the matter. Don Bacardi's design for down there on a visit was particularly successful, I think. Chris says, I replied, saying that you were going to design the jacket and that you already had a good idea for it. And would they please write and say what the deadline is? If you care to write him, not necessary, I think. The new address is Methuen and Company Limited, and so forth. Why is it that one remembers so much to say after one has signed a letter? I have no idea for the jacket of a single man. I mean, one of them, as I suppose you do two different ones, a wrecked automobile turned over in a ditch. It's horribly corny. But I keep thinking of it. What do you say? I like it very much now, the idea, and I'm sorry it wasn't used. And probably because I did design myself, so I'm responsible. Further adventures of Dorothy. Our cesspool backed up and filled both toilets and the kitchen sink with stinking water. I'm just a bit skeptical about this. All seems well now, And how could it have backed up all that far? I've been in that house more than 50 years now and never had such an accident as that, I'm happy to say. Two or three youths attempted to rob a house on Mayberry Road that was just below us. The police chased them. They ran up our stairs to the gate. One of them yelled, "It's locked." So they turned around and ran down again into the arms of the cops. This, the most improbable story of the year, is also told by Dorothy, who claims she watched the whole thing from the balcony. Well, maybe I misunderstood her. Your car isn't here. I presume your father still has it. Tried calling Ted, that's my brother, but so far, no answer. Maybe I don't have the right number. Now, just a few months before, he wrote a letter from Santa Monica, and it was probably the most difficult period of our years together, the time we nearly split up. Monday morning, March 11th, 1963. You have just left, and oh dear, I feel so miserable at the complexity of everything and the difficulty I have in talking to you. I mean, I really understand so much more than I can express in conversation. There's your painting problem. Almost nothing I can do about that. I often feel you don't even want my sympathy, but just for me to get the hell out and leave you alone. That's perfectly all right, but it's among the many things we don't seem to be able to say to each other without hurt feelings on my side, irritation on yours. The irony of it is that you can help me with my writing problems very considerably. So the situation is one-sided. Then there's Bill. That was a young man I was having an affair on the side with at the time. If only we could talk about that. But I guess it's impossible because you feel that I'm trying to own the relationship or sponsor it or whatever you say just by talking about it. But all I really want you to know is that I do see why it has to be, and I'm glad about it. Much more than that, I really do accept it as part of our life together. But even if I say that much, it sounds sort of possessive, as though I were trying to make it into a mere colony of the Kitty Dobbin Empire. Anyhow, I won't pretend that I adore being alone those evenings, but that's my business. It always has been a weakness of mine, and one which I should get over. It's childishness, really, something to do with the dark. Because during the daytime, I couldn't be happier by myself. Well, anyhow, that is connected with these involvements I create. And there, I have to admit, you are right. I am motivated, at least to some extent, by a queenie competitive bitchiness. I see now that the thing with Paul was really inexcusable. Paul was Paul Warner. One of our painter friends who lived with Bill Brown, but they had some sex while I was away, and I suppose I was making the most out of that I could. I simply cannot fathom now how I could have been so thick-skinned. But there again, if only we could talk. Like the evening before last, I had actually just stayed the night at the house where I'd been drinking, purely and simply because they didn't want me to drive back drunk. But I couldn't tell you that, because telling you would have suggested that you minded. And that's the kind of minding we never talk of. We only either kid each other about it or get angry. Oh, I'm so saddened and depressed when I get a glimpse, as I do so clearly this morning, of the poker game we play so much of the time, watching each other's faces and listening to each other's voices for clues. And then you say, for example, Dublin's in a strange mood, and then things start to get tense. And because I know this, I start play-acting to get them untense again, and that makes everything worse. And you are much the same. Although somehow or other, you always seem franker than I am. Is that because you can afford to be? Am I scared of you? Yes, in a way. But I really almost wish I could be more scared. How can I explain that? It's hard. But to try to get at what I mean, I was so happy the other day when you said that about Dobbin having been a jailer and now being a convict. I sort of wish that were true all of the time. Masochism? Oh, Mary, what do I care what it's called? I only know that it isn't a wrong thing for me to feel. Our relationship is really so very, very strange. No wonder it gives us trouble. I mean, I often feel that the animals are far more than just a nursery joke or a cuteness. They exist. They are like Jung's myths. They express a kind of freedom and truth which we otherwise wouldn't have. I've written all this, and maybe having read this far, you will say, what an egomaniac. I have quite other problems, you will say, which have nothing to do with him. Yes, I know that. And again, if I say I would like to talk about them, you may reply that I'm merely trying to get possession of them. I mean, basically, the feeling you have mentioned of fear, what is going to happen to you? What is going to happen? Oh, sweetheart, I probably ought not to send you this letter at all. Perhaps you feel nothing but sick of my interference. I don't forget how you said how you had those feelings of sheer hatred while you were up at Stanford. But then again, I'm going to send the letter because the one thing I do want you to know is that I care. I really do ache with misery when the wires are crossed. But then I realize it is sheer egotism to talk about caring. Oh, shit. I feel I've somehow gotten something said, but I don't quite know what. I love you. See. And then a P.S. In case I forgot to tell you, I suppose I shall have to go to the Hollow Crown with Cecil on Thursday night. Cecil was a good friend. It seems to be remarkable, the tone of that first letter I read. Just months after this heart-wrenching lesson, for me anyway. That's a beautiful letter.
Thank you so much, Don. I have to say, I read many of the letters, most of the letters in this book, and hearing you read them really accentuates, in a way I hadn't been prepared for, the poignancy and the wit and the eloquence of the letters and the intimacy. It's really an extraordinary book. And, you know, I came to know your work really through Christopher Isherwood as a young gay man growing up in 80s England, reading the Berlin novels and then later the diaries. So I always had this perspective of you through Christopher, really, through his diaries. And the remarkable thing about the letters to me is that the sort of equal weight it gives your voice and the power of your voice in these letters, which, for anyone who's familiar with Christopher's work, really is your voice that's striking because it's not one we're familiar with. I'm curious about how important that is for you, having your voice in that relationship heard as fluently as it is in these letters, alongside Christopher's voice in the diaries. Was that a important consideration in bringing these letters into the public domain?
It was easy for me to write to him because he was always so encouraging of me. I would never have become an artist without his encouragement. It was really his idea. When we first got together in early 1953, I was off from it was just after my freshman year at UCLA, and, which was a hideous experience. I just hated that first term. I'd never worked so hard before. I'd taken nothing but solid courses, and I got a B average. I was so relieved, and then I met Chris, and we started seeing each other, and I'd always been drawing since I was a kid, and always from photographs, and usually of movie actors, because I felt I knew them from the movies I'd seen them in, and that was an early bond between Chris and me, because in his teens he was a big movie fan too, and even kept a scrapbook of movie clippings, mostly from Photoplay magazine. And it was he who encouraged me when I showed him my drawings of actors. He recognized them all, and he said, you should think seriously of trying art school. But I was scared of failing, and it took me 3 years before I dared to sign up for a 6-week summer course. And the result was, on the Friday of my first week, I quit UCLA and signed up full-time at the art school in LA, and went with relief. It was such an important discovery of mine to realize that I did have some talent for drawing, and I signed up at Chouinard, and not only went from 9 to 4 for the next 4 years, but was often back there from 7 to 10 at night. It was a long drive downtown for me, back and forth from Santa Monica. But I realized that first week that this was something I could really do, and I made progress immediately. It was such a relief to find my vocation that I couldn't get enough of it. And when I showed my first drawings to Chris, all from photographs. He said, have you ever drawn from life? And I said, no. He said, well, you should try it, and if you want, I'll sit for you. And he did. And I did my first drawing from life of him, and it took me at least an hour, and he sat very, very still. And when I was finished, he got up and stood behind me to look at the drawing, and there was a very long pause before he almost gulped and said, you know, it's good. And that drawing, and I've done hundreds since of him, and I even did drawings of him dying and of his corpse after he was dead, but never did I do a drawing of him that looked as old as that first one. And that was really, I know, very suffering. And I look at that drawing now, and yes, it's just like him, but you see, I got used to working from photographs of movie stars, and of course they'd all been retouched. There wasn't a line in them. So I carefully copied everything I could see in the photographs, and I carefully copied everything I could see in Chris's face. And of course at 48 there were lines and pouches and everything faithfully recorded. And it did look like him, but a very, very old but after that gulp, he said, it's good. And forever after, he wouldn't give up urging me to try art school, finally I did.
I want to talk about one of the most adorable aspects of these letters, and that's your nicknames. I think anyone who's perused the book and heard you just read from Christopher's will be familiar. But, you know, I think all couples can identify with the kind of coded language that people use in relationships. But you two really took it to a whole new level. And I want to just, you know, give you a few instances of your words of endearment for Christopher. Rub-dub, Brumby, Dobbin, sainted rubble, adored velvet hide, treasured steed, revered shagmane, and I think one of my favorites, which almost sounds like a sex toy, golden love plug. and there are literally hundreds of these names. I mean, you're incredibly inventive with them. Catherine Bucknell, who's in the room, who's the amazing editor of this collection, she should really raise her hand. She's here. Suggests in the introduction that these pet names really enabled you both to analyze your relationship objectively in the third person. And I'm really curious about how important writing to each other, these letters, especially as a lot of the time it was long distance writing while you were in London and Christopher was in Santa Monica, how these letters helped you sustain, build, and at times mend your relationship.
Writing letters, of course, we both try to amuse each other, and using those animal names in the letters, already just a few years after we were living together, we were always, when we were alone, Kitty and Dobbin. It was just a language we had. By objectifying ourselves, I think it gave us leeway to play all kinds of scenes. We were always laughing a lot. He was so witty, naturally, I was encouraged to try to keep up with him and to amuse him. So it was fun writing letters. And though we were not often separated, when we were, we did write a lot. and enjoyed it, and always the Kitty and Dobbin. But that was our secret, and I think Kitty and Dobbin would have been absolutely horrified to think that one day our letters to each other would be here in this book published. I think that would have just scandalized them and made them think what could have happened. When I read them again, they just seemed to me funny and fun to read. I just felt they ought to be shared. And Kate, I think, wrote, I love her writing, and the introductions to his books of diaries and a memoir are just beautifully done, but this one is really my favorite of them all, because Kate understood everything that was going on and wrote it so beautifully.
I think one of the things that might surprise a lot of readers is what a shrewd cultural critic you are. And if I may be so bold, since you didn't read from one of your own letters, I just want to read from one of yours very, very briefly. This is Don's review of The Bible, a movie by John Huston, which I haven't had the pleasure of seeing, and I think now I won't. And I'm just quoting a few lines from here. Huston has managed to make a movie about the creation of the world in which nothing happens for 3 hours. Richard Harris as Cain manages to overact with only one line of dialogue. And then Huston as Noah, a case of the cutes that would make Disney turn away and retch. Kitty's attention was held, but only for an instant, when two fat white ponies were lured onto the ark, followed by some very restless, striped and spotted kitties. Clearly very critical of the whole proceedings. I mean, the letters are just full of this incredibly rich cultural life you both had. In one night it's the theatre, the next night it's the cinema, then it's an art exhibition. It really made me feel there's such a paucity of culture in my life. I live in New York City. Was this a reflection of the times you're in, of your social circle? Is it just that you wrote letters after seeing movies and theatre? But you seem to spend an inordinate amount of time exploring art.
Well, you see, it really seems to me that I was waiting for Chris, Sleeping Beauty in a way, being awakened. Because suddenly here was somebody I could really talk to, and who was he was so witty, and he was interested in movies just as much as in books, and we loved going to the movies together. Being with him. Seemed to provide me with an identity for the first time, and pleasing him as best I could was something I loved doing. So I was really inspired, and if I had any kind of success at all, Chris was always so pleased, and he participated. When I would come home from art school, he was always there, "Let me see what you did." And I would show him all the drawings of that particular day, and "Oh, that's a good one." He would pick out the ones he liked best. I never had that kind of attention from either of my parents. It was such an incredible luxury for me, and I wanted to please him as much as he was pleasing me.
one of the things that that I found very instructive in terms of our own relationships, I think, is the level of support you each gave to each other's careers. You were both ambitious people who really wanted to be fulfilled creatively, and it seemed frequently in these letters that Christopher is trying to help you get an engagement and further your career, and you're doing the same for Christopher. But I think one of the things, certainly as a gay man, that was really striking in these letters that were written in the 50s and 60s and 70s, but certainly in the 60s pre-Stonewall, is the level of comfort you both have with your sexual orientation. The fact that neither of you ever question or have any anxieties about being gay men. I found that really enlightening, because you tend to sort of look back on that sort of pre-Stonewall era as quite a dark age, and clearly it was for many people, but you managed to create a world for yourselves in which that was irrelevant.
Because Chris wasn't ashamed of himself. He didn't feel that being queer was something wrong. And that was just so exhilarating for me to know that this a truly intelligent man didn't feel the least shame and encouraged me to be strong as he was himself. So what a terrific role model he was for me in every way. And he was... He really, his writing, I saw he was a perfect example of an artist, because he cared deeply about writing and yet didn't take himself seriously, poke fun at himself. Well, he just educated me in every direction. He really did. Bring me to life, and it made it such fun to be alive.
Well, it's interesting because, I mean, you do see your evolution in these letters, both of you evolving as people, but for me one of the striking things was actually how the 30-year age gap between you completely disappears in these letters. You are two equals, and age seems not to enter into it. You talk to each other as equals, your interests, your level of kind of insight is equal. I wonder, for a lot of people, it seems, that there's still talk about an age difference as if that was problematic, as if you were somehow gullible or taken advantage of. And I wonder if, in bringing these letters to light, if it's important to you to still sort of challenge that perception.
To
challenge that perception.
I lost my train of thought for a moment. What was I going to say?
Because there's no sense in the letters of a gullible young man being taken advantage of. At all.
Oh, yes. The age difference, I think, shocked people at the time. There were some of Chris's friends who, his best woman friend at the time, Peggy Kiskaden, thoroughly disapproved. And Chris knew that she regarded me just as a sign of his middle-aged folly, that he was behaving so stupidly. And and finally he broke with her completely. The age difference actually gave us many more roles to play with each other. Sure, he was a father figure for me, and I never had attention from my own father. He was very remote and was away so much of the time. He worked at Lockheed Aircraft, and it was during the war. So he was often working swing shift, graveyard shift. My brother Ted and I hardly saw him for several years. And even when we did see him, he was remote. We were really much more brought up by our mother, whom we both adored. And in fact, she was amazing in that she never, our mother made any kind of distinction between us. I love you two boys, both of you boys, and we never felt any favoritism from her, and that brought Ted and me together. We quarreled when I was around 5, 6, but by the time I was 7, 8, we were already, well, the movies, the three of us, when my mother was, when my father was working the swing shift, she would take us downtown to movies, and we would maybe go to three movies, one right after the other. And so we had great rapport with her, and that made up for the lack of it with our father. But yes, I was saying the age difference we always felt was a benefit rather than a problem. And I could poke fun at him, and it was just a form of intimacy to call him a shaggy old woman.
In his stable. I could ask a lot more questions, but I want to give some time to the audience here. I see it's actually getting much later than I realized. So would anyone like to volunteer to ask questions over here?
Yes. Did you meet Christopher's... did you meet the family of Christopher as well in England? And if so, how did you get along well together? I can tell her.
Yes, I did meet both his mother, who was quite an elderly woman by the time Chris got involved with me, and she and his brother Richard, who was 7 years younger than Chris, lived alone together in this big, old, damp house called Wibbersley. And Chris and I didn't go to England together until I was 21. Of course, I was already considered an adult when we started living together, but still Chris wanted to be sure, so we didn't travel until I was 21. And because I look very young for my age, and in fact, when Chris first brought me to New York in Christmas of 1953, a serious rumor went around New York that Christopher had brought a 12-year-old with him, and several people reported that to us. That 12-year-old was having a whale of a time. that 2-week Christmas vacation in New York was just so exciting for me. New York seemed the most wonderful place I'd ever been to. And of course, with Chris, he had such fascinating friends, and he took me everywhere with him. And our first trip to Europe, We went around the world. We started in Hawaii and Japan. And so by the time we got to England in early 1956, we'd been traveling a long time. And Chris's first trip to Wibbersley, which was the house that his mother and Richard were living in, he went by himself, and I stayed in our hotel room in London. And I knew that he wanted to prepare his mother for my arrival, because he didn't want her to be rude to me, so that took some preparation. And also, his brother Richard was quite an encounter for me, because though he looked quite a bit like Chris, he also looked like the village idiot. Because he was tousled. Whatever he was wearing was always stained with dribblings down his jacket, his sweater, whatever he was wearing. His two front teeth were missing. And every time we were together, I never caught him looking at me. He was always, like this. And yet I knew that he could give me a minute, give a minute description, physical description of me. Because he wrote to Chris a lot, and Chris had even shown some of his letters, and they were all about people in the village they lived in, and they were very careful, detailed descriptions of the people. They were amazing letters. He really had a talent for writing himself, but he was just so strange looking. And Chris was very careful to prepare him and his mother for me, and careful to prepare me for the two of them, because his mother by that time was already in her 80s. She was almost middle-aged before Chris was born. He was determined that she would behave herself with me, and she did. She was. We got along perfectly.
Yes.
Sorry.
Thank the library, and thank you so much for coming to speak with us tonight. It's a beautiful shade of blue. I just need to tell you, you look so handsome sitting in this light.
I bought the suit especially for my trip.
I wanted to ask a question about the nature of homosexual love, the love between men, and particularly how we've seen so much in our life of change, the gay liberation movement, the indulgence of the 70s, the plague of the 80s, and now marriage. It seems to be more and more we're being seen to be just like straight people. And I wondered if you had any thoughts on, are we just like straight people, and what is the nature of homosexual love?
Well, Chris told me, you see, he made me realize that there was no reason to discriminate between different kinds of love, because if love was genuine, it was the real thing, it didn't matter which sex the people were. If they were loving, they were getting the point. It didn't matter. And of course, that up until that time, I had the idea that homosexuals were despised by society, and hidden mysterious, and though that was kind of exciting too, being so hidden from what was considered healthy society. It had its glamour, but he made me know that there was nothing to be ashamed, that real love, what was important was that it was love whomever you loved. Well, that was exactly what I needed to hear.
Anyone else? No? Well, we are over our allotted 8 p.m. finish, so if there's no more questions, thank you so much, Don. It's been a real pleasure.